which would make it simply a matter of chronology, but as a culture which plunges into a subjectivity that rejects the claims of the world to embrace what he calls a uniquely modern style of salvation, a salvation by, of, and for the self. In this disintegrated consciousness, the modern world has lost the belief in a collective destiny. Men no longer feel themselves bound in a sacred destiny and often enough in a temporal kinship. The inevitable outcome of this advance is a descent into legalism, whose only limit is limitlessness. He says, legalism lies at the center of all that we mean by modernist literature, both as subject and symptom, a demon overcome and a demon victorious. The terror which haunts the modern mind is that of a meaningless and eternal death. The characteristics of how found in literature and the arts of the late 1960s have seeped out into the texture of daily life. We find ourselves more than a century further on in a world still mired in its commitment to limitlessness, to unending economic growth, to unending and hence directionless quality improvement, to a pursuit of limitless power, to the emptiness of a value-free moral outlook where all that counts as good is the maximization of private, that is subjective, preference, justifiable solely by the unfettered assertion of autonomous choice. In this situation, we must ask whether there is any room for the ancient and traditional commitment to a common good that is anything more than a temporary contingent convergence on some set of public interests, as often as not of purely a materialistic sort. This paper seeks to explore and contrast the traditional and modern notions of social good by considering the implications of how a difference plays out in just two of many areas of life, namely in the interpretation of law and in the administration of healthcare, areas that are constantly intersecting with our day-to-day experience. We will begin by examining the traditional natural law vision of the common good and then compare that with a contemporary discussion which shifts away from the natural law approach and towards a view focused on the ways different groups wish to think about the instrumental significance of various common goods or interests. These considerations will open the path to look at the role that absolute egoism, also known as expressive individualism, has come to play in recent ethical discussion. We'll be looking at the interrelated analyses of these issues offered by several authors from different areas of expertise, bioethics, policymaking about matters of life and death, and interpretation of constitutional texts. So first, natural law, common good. Some general background. As early as the 4th century BCE, Aristotle, in his Politics, made the point that a society must be united in the pursuit of a common purpose, a good that binds its members to seek the flourishing of all, whether it be an extended family as the basic unit of the polis, or a small group of such families forming a village, or an entire self-contained polis, that is, the city. For Aristotle, that could necessarily add a moral dimension, leading the entire community to eudaimonia, or happiness, or in today's language, flourishing, which is ultimately a state of the soul, though material things are also good in view of what they may contribute to the life of the soul. In the long run, though, each one has just as much of happiness as he has of virtue and wisdom and of virtuous and wise action, Aristotle says. For Aristotle, the flourishing of one person cannot be achieved apart from the flourishing of the entire community. For for practical purposes, St. Augustine, in the early years of the 5th century CE, after Rome had already fallen to the Visigoths, and with the Vandals advancing into North Africa from Spain on the west, writes the De Civitate Dei on the city of God, adopting a similar viewpoint to that of Aristotle in what concerns the necessity of a common purpose to define a state or inner society. But he sees the transcendent nature of Christian theological virtues as completing and elevating in the city of God whatever natural virtue might be attained in the city of man. The bottom line is that human flourishing, which is the purpose of society, can only be achieved by the life of virtue, whether acquired by human exercise or infused by the grace of God. In the 13th century, St. Thomas Aquinas also adopted the Aristotelian position, adapting it to a harmonious, to harmonize it more closely with Christian thought. At the heart of Aristotle's view was the nature, the humanity of the human being. And this fit very well into Thomas's understanding. So too did Aristotle's insistence that the human is specifically a political animal. Thomas was situated to reintroduce Aristotle's distinction between the person as a human and as a citizen in relation to the state. Two different kinds of relationship. Once that was well established, Thomas could also give meaning to talk of a political government as a natural outgrowth of the political animal, associated naturally in a political state. Since the church was a supernatural entity, the distinction between the congregation of the faithful and the assemblage of the citizens of the state could make sense. Human flourishing could truly be the responsibility of the political entity without diminishing the spiritual community. An exhaustive history of the concept of common good is beyond the scope of this paper, so it may be helpful to move to a more recent presentation. There are a number to choose from, notably that of Jacques Maritain in his 1951 book, Man and the State, which has become ensconced in recent Catholic treatments, though Maritain's ethical and political views had earlier come under attack by Charles de Koninck in his 1941 monograph, The Primacy of the Common Good Against the Personalists, the Principle of a New Order. But that dispute may have its own interest. It may turn on whether what de Koninck calls personalism was actually a form of individualism with which Maritain's thought might or might not have been tainted. Instead of pursuing that question here, a different, less controversial author may be introduced. Johannes Mesmer's Social Ethics, Natural Law, and the Western World first appeared in English translation in 1958, though it had been published nearly a decade earlier in German. In Book One, The Foundation, Part Two, The Nature of Society, Social Philosophy, Mesmer devotes sections 22 to 31 to an extensive discussion of the common good. His central claim is that the term points to the goal of a particular society in relation to its members, who are understood to be unable as single members to attain their full flourishing. To capture what the common good is, Mesmer describes it as the help which all require for the fulfillment by their exercise of personal responsibility of vital tasks rooted in existential ends. So, here, this is what we're talking about, and this is what I was just mentioning. It's got the reference there. So, to try to capture that, he talks about tasks rooted in the essential ends of the human being. that are ones that are not undertaken in pursuit of private agendas, but ones that contribute to the flourishing of the community as such, and therefore on behalf of all its members. The ends are those that every member of society has simply in virtue of being human. Thus he calls them human existential ends. They are rooted in what Messner terms integral human existence. Any human being would be deprived of the fullness of life without such ends being attained, and at the same time as existentially social beings. They must rely on one another to help them towards those ends. This may sound very abstract, so we need to fill in the concrete items that are involved. Messner identifies the pursuit of the common good as the establishment of peace. And peace and public welfare. These need to be filled in even more concretely by pointing out the peace that is sought will produce an order of freedom which will relate all spheres of human social responsibility and do so within a culture that is dynamic, that dynamically embraces the spiritual, intellectual, and moral spheres of human life, including the true, the good, and the beautiful. At the same time, the public welfare will be so structured as to produce an order of distribution relating to the material sphere of human life in such a way that the activities of the members contribute to and are rewarded proportionately in the functioning of the society. This is the nature of the common good in Messner's terms. Perhaps a more contemporary usage might answer the parable. The members of a society, by their efforts on behalf of the orders of freedom and distribution, synergistically carry all towards the peace and public welfare that constitute the common good. There's a certain openness about how a society may practically pursue the common good. That means that the forms which the pursuit will take do not have to follow a cookie-cutter pattern. What will work best for pursuing the common good in an agrarian community in 5th century BCE Mesopotamia may look quite different from what happens in a medieval hill town in Italy, and that again may be remarkably unlike an industrial town in 19th century England. Not only are the possibilities available to the people living in each of these settings quite diverse in terms of technologies, but also in terms of the understandings that people have about the demands of life at these widely separated farms and places. But the common good can be pursued in each situation because in all cases, the members of those societies are human beings with the same human existential needs and corresponding goals. The common good, then, is the good or the goal sought by a society as a whole and by each of its members so that each and all can attain to the fullness of human flourishing. Aristotle conceived of this as a life of virtue yielding eudaimonia, the flourishing of spirit that is often called happiness. Whether any particular society chooses to call its common good by that name, the expectation is for all practical purposes the same. Of course, it's very possible that because a society chooses unsuitable means to attain its common good, the outcome may fall far short. Or the same might result from a flawed conception of the common good that leads to the choice of a system of governance that pursues its own good rather than the common good of the populace. But that's typical. The problem in any tyranny. Messner observes that the common good consists ultimately only in goods and values actualized in the members of society. This must be stressed particularly at a time when the progress of society too much in terms of institutions, organizations, and technique. Notice in his remarkable phrase, in the members of society. The reality of the common good is the internal to them, not something external that they can possess and divide up for private enjoyment. What makes common good common is, at least in part, its integral indivisibility, which allows it to be shared without being diminished. Indeed, the opposite is true. The more sharers there are, the more the good expands, the more there is to revel in, the more in which to flourish. Common goods, instrumental meanings of common goods. So we're going to come down here to the next slide, please. And we'll have to go back for the other thing to compare to. The issue of the instrumental means and devices that are sought to foster the common good, according to Messner, need to be seen as components of the goods and values, but nonetheless as belonging to a subordinate realm of service to the common good. What might these include? Messner offers the following description. Along with this of such goods serving the common utility could be made. They would include chiefly the legal system, the public educational system, the public health service with its hospitals and research institutes, social welfare institutions, the defense forces and the police, and public utility services for transport, water, and light. All these institutions are means in the service of the common good, which ultimately consists in goods and values. In law and order of society, the guaranteed freedom of its members, the opportunity for all to pursue their essential tasks in life on their own responsibility and by their own efforts, a sound state of health in society as a whole, the ensuring of the foundations of economic life for the immediate future and the coming generations. These types of common goods that serve the common good may be termed variously public goods or common interests or other equivalent expressions. What is important to remember is that in the traditional understanding of the common good, they are instrumental means. The choices that a given society makes about them involve practical reasoning about how available resources may be allocated to achieve the common good. Time, place, population, etc., all need to be considered prudentially. And the virtue of prudence will be directed, as always, by the understanding of what is worthy of human nature. The lists the various authors may produce might differ in emphasis, some mentioning either explicitly that another subsumes implicitly under another heading, but what the lists contain will be justified by what the common good of society demands. An important clarification needs to be made about societies. Ordinarily, the focus of discussions about the common good is those sorts of large societies that we think of as states. In terms of size, an extended family, too, is a much smaller society. Between such extremes, there are also groupings termed intermediate societies. All of these have ends that they pursue, and corresponding to those, a common good relevant to each sort of society. I know it can be very abstract, so let me give you an example of that, which hopefully will also shed light on even the common good of state. So consider a fairly large group with a shared goal as a fully integrated design-build enterprise. That is to say, it lacks none of the essential technical skills and trades, the material supply structures, and so forth to execute a major construction project. In the process, everyone, the architects and engineers, the electricians and plumbers, the bricklayers, and all the other trade specialists exercise the virtues of their practices as they each and all contribute their part to the project at appropriate times. coordinating their work for the shared goal of this project. As they do so in every similar project undertaken by the enterprise. Notice that when the project is complete, if any single one of those people were to proclaim, "I built this," it would be an obvious lie. The truth is that all must say, "We built this." Out of the variety of specialized practices that each brought to the project, it was completed not by any isolated task of a single individual, or even by a simple addition of successive isolated tasks, but only by the integration of all of them. The integration is what points to a common good of the enterprise as an intermediate society. That common good lies not in the achievement of that project, nor in the collection of the monetary fees charged for the work, nor in the aggregate of the skills of individual workers, but in the intentional merging of all those skills for the shared execution of the project. The enterprise as a whole and all its members thrive as this particular kind of society because of the integration of all the contributions, none of which would suffice in and by itself to achieve the whole, the resulting state of affairs. All can rightly celebrate the common achievement and enjoy a personal satisfaction in saying, "We did that together." Happiness, in other words, and peace in a limited sense. I hope that example serves to form a better notion of what is meant in the natural law tradition of common good. If we shift to a higher order society, we would be able to find suitable comparisons if that group is truly a society with a real common good. Now, I'm skipping the next several sections about various kinds of goods, how we can identify human goods, and some other things about them. So we've now looked a bit in detail into some background about common good. We've explored the natural law account of common good, and we've seen something of the importance of the instrumental means to achieving the common good. Now we must look at a contemporary view of common good and the implication it has for anticipating the misunderstandings that might well arise between those who operate with this contemporary perspective and those familiar only with the pre-modern natural law. So we go back up. Thank you. So there's a shift in basic perspective that goes on historically. If the natural law perspective that we've just been describing is rooted in ancient and medieval conceptions of the human person and society, the contemporary outlook finds its roots in modern thought. Though not all its admirers hold the extremely pessimistic view of Thomas Hobbes that men are radically antisocial and only driven to associate by a need to prevent constant mutual destruction, there is a broader acceptance of John Locke's proposal that the reason they come together to form a social contract is to have greater convenience in enjoyment of the world's goods. In both instances, no natural social impulse is seen in individuals. Whether it be for the sake of basic survival or the facility of collective productivity, society is just an artificial invention, not a normal natural state of affairs. Hobbes depicted the human as an atomic individual. Locke did not deny that. Nor, for that matter, did any of the other enlightened thinkers raise their voices against it. The consequence is that talk of anything common must somehow be the result of some agreement authorized under the social contract in vigor. Once more, there is no room for a natural commonality in finding or acknowledging a slate of goods, let alone a unifying common good. The tyranny and such a burden of natural goodness have to be rejected along with all other forms of oppression to give full expansion to the sovereign individual freedom to decide for itself what it would deem good, absolutely free of any intrusion from the preferences of others. Each such sovereign individual must take his stand in the light of reason alone to assert this right to his own preferences, unconstrained by any force but his own autonomous choice to join in living under a particular social contract. A secular version of the declaration attributed, perhaps unfairly, to Martin Luther at his trial before the Diet of Worms in May of 1521. Here I stand, I can do no other. Every radical individual thinks that way. The portrait I've just painted of the atomic, autonomous individual is the reason for the second part of the title of this lecture, Idiocy. The word is strong in English and attention-grabbing, at the very least. It's not used to cast aspersions on anyone in particular, but it reminds us of the Greek adjective idios, which means something separate, private, apart, peculiar to oneself alone. It is a word which captures what is especially characteristic of the atomic, autonomous individual of modern liberal thought, the kind of mindset typical not only of American political arrangements, but also of much of the Western European world as well. It is the heritage of the Enlightenment, the essence of the so-called modernist project that I spoke of back in the introduction. As we proceed, the implications of this sort of asocial, if not antisocial, notion of the individual will come to light. So if you will indulge me, instead of repeating ad nauseam the phrase atomic autonomous individual, allow me just to abbreviate it with an AAI. That's what I mean if I said that. So anyone who wishes to begin in the most accessible way to find out what a term is about, we go first to Wikipedia, where you find the following introductory comment. In philosophy, economics, and political science, the common good, also commonwealth, general welfare, or public benefit, is either what is shared and beneficial for all or most members of a given community, or alternatively, what is achieved by citizenship, collective action, and the active participation in the realm of politics and public service. Good old Wikipedia. I'm not going to go on that. There's another more adequate discussion in the Stanford University Encyclopedia of Philosophy online by an author named Joaquin Hussein. He begins his exposition thus. In ordinary political discourse, the common good refers to those facilities, whether material, cultural, or institutional, that the members of the community provide to all members in order to fulfill a relational obligation they all have to care for certain interests that they have in common. Some canonical examples of the common good in a modern liberal democracy include the road system, public parks, police protection, public safety, courts and judicial system, public schools, museums and cultural institutions, public transportation, civil liberties such as freedom of speech, freedom of association, the system of property, clean air, clean water, and the national defense. The term itself may refer either to the interests that members have in common or to the facilities that serve common interests. For example, people may say, the new library will serve the common good, or the public library is part of the common good. So we can begin by noting that the definition just given equates the common good with facilities provided to all members of the community in pursuit of their shared interests. notice how different that is from what we saw over here. It's a very dramatic difference in outlook. The list of examples overlaps the instrumental means we want to come back to. I'm not going to read it all out again, but you can see there are parallels somewhere between these that we saw in Messer's account. Indeed, we could see a similar listing to Jacques Maritain's treatment and in others as well. The principal difference is that Hussein's list is not oriented to the attainment of a higher order of good, which all the members could enjoy, both personally and communally. Rather, they are individual goods allotted in sufficient quantity to satisfy the individual members of the group. Consequently, they can be diminished and even lost by being used by more and more individuals added to the group. These facilities, then, are public goods that members would not possess if motivated solely by self-interest. For Hussein, the concept of common good counters a defect of a private society, which would not justify sacrificing private interests for the sake of the interests of others. A form of mutual concern can be encouraged by a commitment to the concept while still acknowledging the legitimacy of private interest that will not necessarily be shared or promoted by mutual action. Certain interests can be taken to be those that individuals have as citizens within a communal conception of the common good. A distributive conception, on the other hand, would regard distinct sexual interests held by different, perhaps competing groups as dividing those groups from one another. Such a division could lead to morally problematic disputes, undermining potential solidarity, and by extension, political deliberation as well. A further difficulty arises when competing economic interests are added to the debate. For Hussein, the concept of common good can act as a side constraint on matters of social justice, including as it does matters of common concern that ideally should guide political deliberation. The difficulty, of course, is that to the extent that the common interests are merely those of independently contracting individuals, sharing no prior overarching moral commitment to a transcendent purpose, there is no guarantee of an optimistic outcome which would reliably minimize division or disagreement. The traditional natural law account of common good does offer such a guarantee, but in the modern era, that is not the option that prevails. We should be careful, then, of mistaking the very similar content of the list of goods, plural, found in both accounts. The items in the modernist version identify interests that many people share. Their ranking, however, must be negotiated, and so the inclusion of some may be subject to serious disagreements amongst the people. It's even conceivable that some items might be excluded if they meet with strong opposition from some members of the group. By contrast, the natural law listing is derived from what the nature of human beings requires for their flourishing. In some situation of severe economic duress, the members might need to consider what level of priority to assign to various items, and the outcome might be a partial, a temporary reduction in the provision of some to ensure that the most central goods are available to as many members as possible. The test for any common good will be how directly and substantively it is needed to attain the common good itself. The basic question, then, that needs to be answered is, are common goods all that we should look for? Or is there ultimately an overarching common good that will govern what can be counted as a common good? The answer we give will have ramifications throughout the lives of the members of the community, both the implications then of the contemporary version of common goods. Let me try to make some connections here to begin. The modern version of common goods did not spring onto the scene without earlier adoption of related notions. Reaching back to thinkers such as John Duns Scotus, Franciscan, who lived from 1266 to 1308, we find an emphasis on the centrality of the human will. This would not be a major problem because what motivated Scotus's position was the idea that union with God in eternity would be an act of love, a work of the will. This position, called voluntarism, would later take a different, less wholesome turn. In the next generation, William of Ockham, 1285 to 1347, also a Franciscan, by the way, put the idea of nature in question, adopting the position called nominalism, that nouns that we use for genus and species, for example, such as canine versus collie, are merely a convenience of our limited minds, which cannot handle giving unique proper names to each and everything we encounter. Things share nothing in common. They are each unique, isolated, atomic entities. When we call several of them Albert, Bartholomew, and Charles, we are respecting those distinct identities. When we call all three men, we are not saying something true. And even more problematically, when we say something like all men are rational beings, we are just trying to cover our ignorance. In the long run, trying to establish that all men ought to tell the truth will not be possible to justify on grounds of a common human nature. Maybe Albert always ought to tell the truth, but perhaps Bartholomew never ought to do so. And as for Charles, perhaps a few lies here and there will be just fine. It will be up to each to make an autonomous decision about what to do. For there can be no universal rule that applies to all. This last step in Ockham's position is advanced especially once Pico della Mirandola, 1463 to 1494, published his Oration on the Dignity of Man in 1486. Asserting that what gives the human being a unique place in the world, a dignity, is the exercise of free will. All the foundation stones that would be needed for the construction of AAIs from the 16th through the 18th centuries were solidly in place. All that remained was the looming combination of social, political, and religious forces that would spark the Reformation, which in turn would respond to the demand for liberty that would justify the invention of nation states, the diversity of religious denominations, and the emergence of a new economic system called capitalism. Other movements would appear too, such as colonialism, the replacement of legal systems rooted in natural law theory, and their replacement by positivist legal. New political ideas leading to various revolutions and the creation of republics to replace the ancien regime, new artistic expressions such as those of the Baroque and later the Romantic era, to say nothing of the developments of the 20th century, and of course, the rise of industrial production systems. All this effervescence captivated minds, at least in some circles, and obscured the shift values that accompany all these changes, which affected different sectors of societies in different ways and at different rates. But suddenly one day, the world took notice that it was no longer what it had once been. The impression was that all that had happened was inevitable and irreversible. Today, we can see the consequences of these shifts more clearly. Once the traditional common good was reconceived as a list of common interests, the broader notion of true human goods disappears into the mist of all goods are simply the object of autonomous choices of AGIs. The impacts were not immediately visible, obscured by the prevalent language of rights that cast a verbal cloak about the promotion of a dualistic understanding of the human being as an atomic individual whose essence is reduced to a will that asserts itself against other wills. And by the way, my mention of dualism there is to point out that in all of this, the body is important. It just doesn't count anymore. So, the shift in bioethics. O'Carter Sneed sets out the concern in his 2020 essay, What It Means to Be Human, The Case for the Body in Public Bioethics. The subtitle makes clear in just what way the modern view of the human being, emphasizing the non-bodily self, permits a forgetfulness of the totality of the person that leads to an exaggerated emphasis on what the individual can do without the body. It can cogitate. Any mental activity is covered, not just thinking, but importantly, choosing as well. Sneed's first chapter reviews the emergence of public bioethics and the policies adopted surrounding especially matters of the beginning and ending of human life. In seeking what he calls an anthropological solution, Sneed raises the problem of expressive individualism, which is neglectful of the body and the vulnerabilities and dependencies that the body represents, and which call for the virtues that Alistair MacIntyre advocates. Individualism's fatal flaw is that it reduces the dignity of the human being to the agency represented by the choosing will as advanced by people. As the examination of various legislative actions, legal arguments, and court decisions unfolds in the succeeding chapters on abortion, assisted reproduction, death, and dying, Sneed identifies in every instance the weight of expressive individualism's forgetfulness of embodiment, leading to legal positions and public policies in general, which prioritize the autonomy of agents over the dignity of whole persons, living in a web of interpersonal relations. In the conclusion of his discussion, Sneed recommends, in all of these vital areas, the role of law should be able to help create, support, and protect networks of giving and receiving on which we all depend in our vulnerability as embodied beings in time. It should encourage the goods, virtues, and practices that sustain these networks. The law must encourage the cultivation of the moral imagination, allowing persons to see others to whom they owe a duty of care, or from whom they can make a plea for support. And where such networks fail or are altogether absent, the law must be to protect the vulnerable from exploitation and harm, and from the temptation to harm others, or even themselves, in the pursuit of their own desires and interests. This would be warmly embraced by a society striving for the common good envisaged in the account presented by Johannes Meissner. It's a proposal, however, though meant to be understood as made in friendship and solidarity, that simply opens extended debates about the adherence of the common interest vision of common good to balance competing interests of various interpreters of that persuasion, committed ultimately to affirming and enshrining the autonomous choices of AAIs. In a similar vein, Rachel Halliburton pursues a careful analysis of the practice of bioethics as it has come to be conducted in recent time. In the second chapter of her work, she traces the sources of what she calls the troubled self to the moral positions of Immanuel Kant, 1724 to 1804, and John Stuart Mill, 1806 to 1873, who hold incomplete incompatible understandings of the self.
For Kant,
the self is a rational, autonomous entity whose dignity is to be respected at all costs. For him, autonomy consists in discovering and obeying moral duties by logical reasoning. A moral duty must be fulfilled no matter the consequences. By contrast, Mill sees the self as a subject of pleasures and pains whose happiness, identical with utility and pleasure, must be optimized. There are no moral rules beyond the optimization of utility, even if the utility of some individuals must be sacrificed to the greater utility of the larger number. The trouble for the troubled self is that whether one follows Kant or Mill, the self is left to determine for itself what gives it meaning and value. A good life is whatever an intelligent self wants it to be. There is no higher source from which to seek confirmation of one's value choices. The third chapter is devoted to the divided self of liberalism. Building on the views of Kant and Mill, individuals assumed to be self-interested and self-constructing are left to want to define good for themselves, and thus to make not right, but their own choices. In the framework of a system of foundational rules chosen logically to obtain maximum freedom for each individual compatible with the principle that no, or at least the least possible harm to others would occur, that's referred to as the harm principle. John Rawls lived from 1921 to 2002, was a kind of conscience, advanced a scheme like that, carefully ensuring the values of the American political system to be preserved. We don't need to go down that whole debate. Professor Halliburton observes that this approach misses the mark on how we usually see our relationships with others, and particularly misrepresents the way many of our choices are actually made. Furthermore, the ideal of the choosing self assumes that the chooser, for example, a sick person, has the expertise and the capacity to exercise fully autonomous decision making. What is forgotten is the compassion and kindness we owe the person because of the vulnerability they experience due to their illness. Of course, terms like compassion and kindness speak of moral commitments that liberalism cannot generalize for public consideration. In chapter 4, Halliburton provides a detailed analysis of the paradox of the choosing self in the specific context of bioethics. Her critique identifies several serious concerns, beginning with the lack of any demonstration that the liberal framework of moral neutrality should be considered legitimate as superior to other competing concepts. There is an assumption that people will always disagree about what a good life encompasses, and that rational debate cannot reach agreement. A third concern is that the choosing self is then left detached from any moral values or norms, even the harm principle, in making its choices. A fourth concern is that the choosing self is abstracted from political or social commitments beyond a particular liberal conception of freedom. Liberalism offers little or no guidance to assist individuals in discerning what choices they ought to make, what conception of the good they ought to endorse, or values they should hold important. In effect, the choosing self is detached from natural norms. Even their own bodies have no claim to be valued. Halliburton wishes to promote a different model of autonomy. She borrows two models of moral theory from Margaret Ernie Walker to clarify the issue. The first would be a theoretical judicial model attempting to impose a codifiable impersonal guide to moral behavior in a law-like form. This would be the sort of result of the kinds of moral theories handed down by the followers of Kant, Mill, Rawls, and so on. The other, termed the expressive collaborative model, claims that morality arises from roles, identities, relationships within communities where persons live. Instead of morality resulting from the autonomous choice of arrived at by a single individual's exercise of rational reflection, it emerges from a fundamentally collaborative and interpersonal interaction pursued by members situated in communities where they share a common life. In the remainder of the book, Halliburton explores chapter by chapter the implications of beginning not with a dualistic theory of the individual, but as an integral conception of persons whose life is grounded in their embodiment in this world. She reveals a number of components of that reality, including gender, virtue, narrative, suffering, practices, all drawing inspiration from the philosophy of Alistair MacIntyre to make the case that a traditional understanding of autonomy can be retrieved that respects the dignity of the person and the dignity of other creatures as well, I would add, including the person's freedom to pursue goods congruent with human nature in all its concreteness to achieve human flourishing together with a community and not at all in isolation from it. That kind of autonomy is achieved in the process of acquiring virtues that lead to well-being. A full account of the argument in the second half of Racial Power Button's book would require far too much space and time for this presentation. I can therefore only recommend it highly to anyone who wants to reach deep understanding of the issues confronting contemporary moral discussion in general and their application in particular to the field of bioethics. By the way, I have these three books up here if somebody wants to see them and see whether they do. Want to pursue looking into the night further. The third thing here is constitutional interpretation. Adrian Verhoeve brings the perspective of a constitutional legal scholar to the role that common good had in the classical legal tradition compared to the twin notions of originalism and progressivism. In order to retrieve a balanced element. He says, our public law now oscillates restlessly and unhappily between two dominant approaches, progressivism and originalism, both of which distort the true nature of law and betray our own legal traditions. Against both camps, I argue for a view I call the common good constitutional. On this view, the classical tradition should be explicitly recovered and adapted as the matrix within which American judges read our Constitution, our statutes, and our administrative law. The centerpiece of the classical legal tradition is that law should be seen as a reasoned ordering to the common good, the, quote, art of goodness and fairness, unquote, as the Roman jurist Ovid put it. An act of purposive and reasoned rulership that promotes the good of law's subjects as members of a flourishing political community and ultimately as members of the community of people and nations. By the way, I just want to quickly note that removal is not a hack. He is an endowed chair professor of constitutional law at Harvard University Law School. And he's been at it for a long time. So, Bermuda's understanding of law and of natural law is rooted in the teaching of Thomas Aquinas. Not surprisingly, then, his explanation of the common good has the same origin. In concrete terms, the common good will call for law to aim at assuring peace, justice, and abundance, which Verhoeve sees as including health and safety and economic security, sustained by solidarity and subsidiarity. He also argues that the preamble to the Constitution of the United States, viewed in the light of a classical legal tradition shared by its authors, aims to constitute a political authority for the purpose of promoting justice, peace, or tranquility is there, and the flourishing of the res publica, the general welfare. Though the order may differ, the intent is clearly the same as the classical understanding of common good. In the second chapter, he sets out to demonstrate the long classical legal tradition in America, present even before the writing of the Constitution, but forgotten only because of the rise of progressive living constitutionalism and originalism. Nor is Rule alone in making this point, as he references recent historical studies by a number of different authors who, while emphasizing different details, all agree on the main issue of the reliance of American jurists, legislators, etc., upon the classical legal tradition, invoking the concepts of the jus commune, the common law, harking back to the Roman conception of the jus gentium, the law of nations, the jus naturale, natural law, and the jus civile, or civil law. And the distinction between jus and lex, the Latin terms for those things, where jus means that which is established by a higher order of rightfulness, and lex means just a statute produced by some legislator. Until the rise of legal positivism in the early years of the 20th century, we will discuss this in some detail a number of significant cases in which these concepts were at issue in Supreme Court decisions. In this lecture, there will never be time to go into all of those, but it might be helpful to point out a few. Vermeule uses decisions written by Justice John Marshall Harlan from Kentucky in the 19th century. As early as Ziegler versus Kansas in 1887, Harlan's decision in a case concerning the power of the state to regulate the manufacture and sale of intoxicating drinks, he wrote, affirming that power that the government does not interfere with rights of liberty or property when it determines that a product may become harmful to society. He states as justification that, quote, those rights are best secured in our government by the observance upon the part of all of such regulation as are established by competent authority to promote the common good. No one may rightfully do that which the lawmaking power, upon reasonable grounds, declares to be prejudicial to the general welfare. The root of this claim is to be found in the explicit commitment of the U.S. Constitution to the general welfare. Justice Harlan also wrote the decision in Jacobson v. Massachusetts in 1905, upholding the power of the state to impose mandatory vaccinations. Later the same year, he wrote a dissent, citing his own recent decision in Jacobson, in the case of Walker v. New York, in which the majority, in spite of a number of affirmative findings by the court based on general welfare or public interest in other similar cases, ruled against the state law establishing maximum hours and minimum wages for bakers. These examples of reliance on jus naturale, natural law, and jus commune, the common law, are not the only kind of the rule advances. He also notes the employment of jus gentium, the law of nations, in the 1936 decision in United States, the Curtis Wright Export Court. Upholding the power of the president to make illegal the sale of weapons to combatants in an external conflict, namely between Bolivia and Paraguay. Justice George Alexander Sutherland argued in his decision for the majority that the government as a whole had that power in virtue of external sovereignty, and the president have the power to exercise his authority over the handling of external affairs. His decision cannot be accounted for either on originalist or progressivist grounds. It is the jus gentium to which he appeals, making the case that the powers flowing from sovereignty were transmitted prior to the enactment of the Constitution upon the cessation of the external sovereignty of Great Britain. A variety of foreign relations powers, none of which is expressly affirmed by the Constitution, says, nevertheless exists as inherently inseparable from the Constitution of nationality. This court recognized, and in each of the cases cited, found the warrant for its conclusions, not in the provisions of the Constitution, but in the law of nations. The classical legal tradition was alive and well. Chapter 3 argues that originalism is an illusion, since it reflects mainly a rhetorical posture adopted on behalf of a conservative interpretation of the Constitution. There are other conservative interpretations available, for example, a libertarian law that emphasizes individual freedom in a manner unknown to the founders. The other obvious alternative is a Burkean traditionalism, which is inconsistent with the deliberately disruptive, anti-traditional character of originalism. In practice, decisions issued by the originalist members of the present Supreme Court end up invoking very abstract principles supposedly found in the text of the Constitution, but then interpreted in a manner that sounds remarkably like a living constitutional progressive reading. Verhoeven finds the same process at work in the decision written by Justice Neil Gorsuch, a self-declared originalist in Bostock v. Clayton County, which extended the meaning of the 1964 Civil Rights Act in Title VII with respect to the original language of, quote, sexual discrimination, unquote, to include, open quote, sexual orientation and gender identity, unquote. He writes, the court found sexual orientation and gender identity to be encompassed with sex discrimination by a but-for reminiscent of an analytic philosophy seminar. Quote from the decision. If the employer fires the male employee for no reason other than the fact that he is attracted to men, the employer discriminates against him for traits or actions it tolerates in his female colleague. The fact that no one in 1964 thought that sexual orientation or gender identity discrimination were encompassed within sex discrimination was deemed irrelevant. That is mere expected expectation, applications of original. Of originalism, whereas the semantic principle embodied in the statute, properly understood, turned out to be much broader than the people who wrote it required. What has happened is that Justice Gorsuch has effectively ignored or failed to understand that originalism tries to capture the ordinary public meaning at the time of enactment, not the literal public meaning. That is the very move that originalists charge against progressive constitutionalist readings. Chapter 4 takes up progressivism and developing constitutionalism in various forms. Peru notes that progressivism is rooted in a particular mythology of endless liberation through the continual overcoming of a reactionary past. It distorts the real nature of law by instrumentalizing it to serve the will of individuals who seek liberation from any and all unchosen restraints. If one sees only the dichotomy between originalism and progressivism, one might imagine that common good constitutionalism would have to be a form of progressivism. Vermeule rejects that conclusion, while illustrating that common good arguments can accommodate a developmental sensitivity with the decision in Village of Euclid versus Amber Realty Company, written by Justice Sutherland. hugely concerned with the validity of the zoning enactment by the village. As a matter of usability, determination of what would best serve the common good of the citizens, the court deferred to the authority of the village government. What makes the decision relevant to the present question is that Justice Sutherland argues that new conditions, such as the introduction of automobiles and rapid transit railways, require a reconsideration of restrictions on certain kinds of activity that had never before been possible. He writes that, while the meaning of constitutional guarantees never varies, the scope of their application must expand or contract to meet new and different conditions which are constantly coming within the field of their operation. In a changing world, it's impossible that it should be otherwise. Unquote. Once more, we can see how the classical legal tradition handles contemporary matter in view of the common good. Extrapolating from that point, Vermeule also builds an argument that the classical legal tradition can readily accommodate a project for the International Affirmation of Human Rights based on the common good rather than a progressive agenda based on absolute autonomous individualism. Doubtless such a project rooted in the common good and thus in natural law will diverge from any plan put forward in the interests of progressives. To complete this picture, let's just think about Adrian Vermeule's concluding paragraph in the book. Let us imagine, even if only as a thought experiment, that lawyers in Europe, the New World, and beyond were right when, for almost two millennia, they thought of law as the art of justice, goodness, and fairness, and thought that the right conception of justice looked to the common good of the community, not at a legal order, merely to an individual autonomy and preference satisfaction. If so, then a legal order in which the originalist party denies that law is the art of justice at all, and the progressive party denies that justice transcends the satisfaction of the individual will, rubs against the grain of reality. Sooner or later on this view, law's real nature will reassert its claims. So in the course of this lecture, we began by examining the nature of the common good from two very different points of view. We examined the traditional natural law understanding, which sees the common good as the goal that a community seeks to bring its members to full flourishing in a way that no individual alone would be able to achieve. That would be a condition in which each member can experience profound peace in an order of freedom, linking all the spheres of human social responsibility within a culture that fosters spiritual, intellectual, and moral flourishing, and well-being or public welfare, which produces an order of distribution linking the material spheres of life so that the activity of the members contribute to and are rewarded by the full functioning of the community. Given what the common good is to be, members of communities discover a bundle of goods that operate as means to achieving the common good itself, but such common goods should not be confused with it. The members of the community share in the practical reasoning that brings them to identify, gather, work upon, and distribute all these sorts of goods in a proved benevolent way. Next, we look at a contemporary view of common good that arises out of the Enlightenment conception of the human being as an independent, autonomous entity who chooses goods to have and facilities to share with others on the basis of some form of negotiation. The human is not seen as naturally social, so the arrangements must need to be changed from time to time, with a resulting redistribution of goods, services, etc. The difference that characterizes these two visions of common good results from the way common goods are to be identified. In the traditional vision, it is the functioning and the capacities of human beings objectively discovering in themselves what is needed for full flourishing. In the modern view, there is nothing higher to be sought beyond a social convention that works for a given group of individuals pursuing their individual purpose. projects. In recent decades, a rebirth of interest in the classic understanding rooted in natural law theory has led to critiques of the way decision-making takes place. We saw briefly how O'Carter-Sneed observes the powerful emphasis on individual autonomy and public policy choices about beginning and ending of human life. Similar discomfort led Rachel Halliburton to analyze the process of decision-making in bioethics, emphasizing the autonomy of choice of individuals whose bodily situation is left out of consideration. Finally, we saw how Adria de Rule identifies a break from traditional legal reasoning rooted in natural law, law of nations, common law, and civil law, all seen as leading to the attainment of the common good for persons living naturally in communities. Instead of that direction to the common good, there are two strains of interpretation with varying substrains, both deriving their credentials from the same individualism and autonomy focused viewpoint of the Enlightenment, both serving the AAIs presumed to be the only motivations humans could have. The originalist, often libertarian version looks for as many ways as possible for individuals to express their liberty with as little restraint as possible, while the progressive version pursues a more socially concerned advancement of rights. In the end, both leave all moral matters in the private sphere, inaccessible to public discourse or substantive debate. Both sides insisting on attributing meanings to terms rising up from within the dark depths of the individual, with no sure connection to reality and no basis for reasoned agreement or disagreement. Verrill is optimistic that a recovery of the classic legal tradition can bring us all out of the endless bickering of the originalists and the progressives. Halliburton sees in a return to the virtue ethics urged by Alistair McIntyre a redemption from the value-free assertions of autonomous choosers. See, too, looked in the direction of McIntyre for a way back from the brink of value-free public policy choices in matters of life and death. All three of these authors seem to be on the right path. If we rediscover the fullness of our human nature and integrated unity of mental and bodily capacities about which we can sensibly discuss how best we can exercise them for all of us to flourish, we will be able to begin to retrieve a mutually respectful public discourse, a reasoned political discussion grounded not on the selfish demands of AAIs, but on the acknowledged capacities of humans that yearn to be exercised. In a world where true human flourishing for all is our common goal, the voices of your greed will be silenced, not by cancer, but by the pain of guilty consciences, recognizing that they are out of harmony with all those seeking to flourish and to help others flourish. Everyone was right. We humans are made for community. Hobbes was wrong. We humans are not made for isolation. Though our modern culture indoctrinates us with expressive individualism, we naturally see